Right. So here's a slide of some of the products and services that you may have come across. What do all of these products and services have in common? Some of these are web apps that we use to buy things like eBay or Amazon. And some of these are services that we use for entertainment and transportation, like Netflix, Spotify, and Uber. If you're not very familiar with this particular logo on the top right, top left rather, it's a Weibo. It's a microblogging platform in China with over 445 million users on it. On this slide are also devices that we use for entertainment, communication, and transportation. The SUV that you see on the slide is the Tata Nexon, which is available both as a fuel-based vehicle as well as a fully electric vehicle. The cool thing about that is it is a connected vehicle that uses APIs to publish real-time telematics data and uses APIs to offer features like geofencing, vehicle location, natural voice systems that both supports both Hindi and English. Some of you may be using the LG OLED smart TV that's on the screen. The smart TVs use APIs to deliver streaming content and support different applications on it. On the lower left rather, you will see the Philips Hue. It is a color-changing smart LED bulb that can be controlled wirelessly through an app. So what do all of these products and services have in common? All of these products and services are heavily dependent on APIs. So APIs are being used by modern businesses in various ways. In some businesses, APIs are actually the product itself. It's not an extension to the product. It's the primary source of revenue, like in the case of Amazon Web Services and Skype. In certain cases, APIs projects the product, or APIs are used to project the product. So when an API is a means for partners or mobile apps or third parties to experience the product and integrate with it, like in the case of Spotify and eBay. Some organizations use APIs to promote the product. So when you can use an API to advertise a product using different channels and or allow third parties to access the data used to generate interest in your product, like in the case of what Amazon and Netflix does. And then in some cases, APIs power the product, where the API is a channel to get new content value into the business. The API can continuously receive new content, which is used to make up part of the service, like in the case of YouTube, Twitter, and Facebook. So, like I said, APIs play a crucial role in each of these businesses. So, APIs, you would have heard from even some talks that were there on yesterday, especially in the talk that Nuan did, that APIs are the most important aspect for some of these businesses to rely on. Therefore, it is quite evident that APIs are indeed the products of the 21st century. And I think throughout the talks, we've clearly established that that point. So APIs are how digital value is delivered through these products and services in the 21st century. They are monetized directly or indirectly. In the indirect case, they act as the fundamental components that create the platform the businesses are built on. Then APIs are also treated as an encapsulation of an asset. So they are, because of that, they are intermediated, increasingly intermediated, traded, and marketed. And these APIs are traded and marketed not only between organizations, but also within an organization. There can be several business units or strategic business units, portfolios. They can have their own APIs. And each of these can own a certain data or capability core to the business. And they may share these amongst themselves as APIs. So if you look at WSO2 customers, there are very good examples of products of the 21st century within WSO2 customers as well. They are delivered to the market using different mechanisms. Some of them are monetized directly, like I said before, and some of them are indirectly monetized as they form the backbone of the product or service that the company offers. Some make APIs available in an external facing marketplace, and some make them, available only in an internal marketplace or only to their partners in a B2B fashion. OCBC Bank, which was one of the featured customer talks from yesterday, has some of their platform APIs in an external marketplace. Société Générale, that you see on the bottom right, is the second largest bank in France. It does a bit of both, external and internal. So Société Générale have many subsidiaries with diverse businesses, from banks to insurance companies to car rental services. Each of these subsidiaries can have their own marketplace, either internal or external facing. But Société Générale also has an organizational-wide internal API marketplace where all their subsidiaries publish their APIs onto. So the expectation in doing that is one subsidiary may come up with a product or service that may in turn be used by another another subsidiary's API. Such value additions are encouraged through collaborations. So therefore, APIs provide direct or indirect value. So from what we have seen, working with so many integration projects, so many customers on API management projects, it is quite obvious that we must associate some sort of a value to an API. And we believe that an API can have some sort of an economic value, and this is what this talk is about. Economic value of an API, we believe, can be broken down into three categories. First, the individual value an API brings. So if you take the API on its own, what's the individual value the API brings? Then yesterday's keynote, Shankar spoke about API supply chains. So there is some sort of value that flows within an API supply chain as well. That is what we call as an API value chain. So the value that flows within an API supply chain. And if you connect these value chains together, the compound effect that you might have in connecting these multiple API value chains together, which we call as API value networks. So that's another level of economic value that you can have associated with an API. So here on, what we are going to look at value aspects separately. So first, let's look at value APIs or APIs that provide value. So I'd like to propose certain principles that are tied with the economics of APIs. So here is principle number one. APIs are the encapsulation of intellectual property. Now, let me take an example of a WSO2 customer and explain this scenario. Dialog is a Sri Lankan telco that is part of the Axiata Group, which is one of the largest telco providers in the Asia Pacific region. They have about 7 subsidiaries in that region. Being a traditional telco, Dialog, as well as its other partner companies, over the years have been challenged by over-the-air providers such as Skype. So a couple of years back, Dialog came up with an API management platform and a marketplace using WSO2 technology. So when telcos were challenged by these over-the-air providers, telcos were compelled to do something to reinvent themselves, differentiate themselves to fight off this challenge from the over-the-air providers. So they turned to the data that they already have. which until that point was just stored and just used on internally for their own purposes. So this is kind of their intellectual property. Now, exposing some of this data out as APIs or using APIs, telcos are able to leverage the data that they have about their subscribers and in which they use various services. And they are, like in the case of Dialog, for example, they were able to create a platform for third parties to make use of this data for the, you know, in cases like advertising, introducing additional value-added services, and so on. So this particular API platform and marketplace called IdeaBiz, in the first 18 months itself, had 2,500 developers creating 3,300 apps using Dialog's APIs. So telcos have a lot of data about their customers. They have the call data, the location data, internet usage data. They know what sites the consumer may have browsed. So telcos can use this data and combine this data with other things like market trends, environmental factors, and industry trends and things like that. And then come up with some interesting insights about their consumer base. So this, the way that they do it, this data as well as these insights that they generate is their intellectual property. So organizations like telcos can use this type of intellectual property and expose them as APIs to allow wider usage and then easier usage of the data within the organization, and then also encourage reuse of this wherever possible. So when you reuse something like this, now this is data that would have, you know, been only used by maybe one group or one business unit before. Exposing this as an API allows these data and capabilities to be shared within the organization, and that reuse can have a compound effect on the technology return on investment. Because reuse allows you to gain more by doing less. And also exposing such IP as APIs allows you to easily monetize it as well. So because of that, one of the key principles with the economics of APIs is that APIs must encapsulate something that is of intellectual property to the organization. Right, so far we've discussed about success of APIs in the 21st century. However, it is also a known fact that a large number of API projects also fail for various reasons. Some of these logos that you see on the screen you might be familiar with are eventually digital projects that failed or were taken off the market went out of use over time. For example, Orkut that you see on the screen, it used to be a very popular social media platform in certain countries like Brazil and India. It never really caught up the market beyond that, as they envisioned. Then next to it are Google Buzz, Google Plus, and Google Wave. They're all Google's attempts at building a social media platform. That had some sort of traction over the time and then eventually failed. A famous one is MySpace, once again, which went down after the, after Facebook beat it in its game, that became the most popular social media platform eventually. And then MySpace went away because of that. Then Napster is a music file sharing service. They got into a lot of trouble because of copyright infringements and things like that. And then they went off the grid as well. However, they paved the way for other services like Spotify, Apple Music, and so on, that are now very popular because they are streaming music services. Once again, heavily based on APIs, but also keep that intellectual property part or copyright parts intact in how they do the business or honor all of that. Then Picasa is a web-based photo album, which was active until very recently and then slowly died because of Google Photos, which kind of took over because Picasa was owned by Google as well. And then the one on top, Lego Universe, is a massively multiplayer online game that Lego, as a toy company, heavily invested in, that was once again based on APIs, but went out of business as well. And the last one on the bottom right is Alta Vista, which used to be one of the primary search engines used in the 90s. That obviously got beaten by Google. So projects like this can fail for various reasons. Some of the projects may fail due to security failures or security breaches that may happen. And security is a very important aspect of an API, value chain and a supply chain. So later during the day, Ayesha is going to talk about the role of identity and access management and how API security comes into play in an integrated API supply chain. So because of that, I'm not going to go into detail on that aspect. But one of the key reasons for API projects failing is not really adding any value through your APIs. So there are many instances that we've come across where a customer sets up an API platform, but the project fails due to the lack of business value or lack of value for the customer. We've seen initiatives where, let's say, someone higher up in the organization decides to use APIs, but they do not think or strategically plan it beyond merely having just APIs implemented. The focus, unfortunately, tends to be purely on the technical aspects of having APIs. But what we are trying to highlight here is that you need to think beyond just having the APIs and how you deliver and think about not just the technical aspects, but also how you deliver the product to your potential consumers. And then how your potential consumers discover the API, try it out, integrate it with easily. All those things are what really adds value to an API. That brings us to the principle number two, which is focus on value programming interfaces. So each of the products that we've discussed so far, be it a physical product, an application, or a service, deliver some sort of value to the end users. That's what makes consumers use it, pay for it, and sometimes become so fond of it that they can become even fans about that service or the brand name. So what really enables the delivery of this value are the APIs that are associated with this product. So APIs are the interface through which we deliver value to the consumers. And this was one of the key highlights in Nuan Dias's talk yesterday. So when you come up with an API, as a principle, focus on the value that it provides and treat them as not just as application programming interfaces, but value programming interfaces. Look at the APIs from a business perspective, because we often tend to only look at APIs only from a technical perspective. So that's principle number two. And then if you look at why organizations or how organizations use APIs, a large number of organizations use APIs to do various things, but from this particular extract from Visual Capitalist, you can see that a large number of organizations use APIs to deliver new partnerships. Then similarly, a large number of organizations also use APIs to exploit new business models, develop new business channels, and then differentiate offers from competitors. So the integrated API supply chain get your API product to the customer. That's what the supply chain is all about. The API value chain is what eventually gives you a competitive advantage. And how do you achieve this? You achieve this by having your APIs deliver value to one or more stakeholders. Who are the stakeholders of your APIs? Right? So you may have internal developers who use your APIs to build their own other APIs or apps. You may have external developers who use these APIs to build other APIs or apps. Or you may be using these APIs to share data or functionality with some of your partners. So there are a couple of ways that you can add value to your APIs. First thing is, obviously, the API must do something useful like we have discussed so far. But what you can also do is when you design your APIs, you can design them in such a way and then build something around that API so that whoever who uses your APIs, the stakeholders, you make them do less work when they use your APIs. So you make it easy to use, you make it easy to integrate. And what you can also do is you can also give them APIs that are ready to use and has high quality enriched data. Now, what I mean by this is sometimes one of the API consumers may have to use your API, get the data, and they may have to do certain processing with that data to make it meaningful for themselves or for the devices that they are showing this data on, so on and so forth. But what you can do is if you have ways and means of providing the data in such a form that they can directly use the data, and it's the data is enriched so that's of higher quality and it has certain cross-cutting information that they can use for various things, that becomes high quality enriched data. So you can also do something similar for the functionality that you share through APIs as well. Give them access to advanced functionalities. And when you do this, what happens is you get them to focus. So it becomes very easy to use your API and integrate with it. And eventually the people who consume your APIs, you get them to focus on what they do best, which is enhancing the consumer experience of their product and use your APIs to facilitate that. And the other thing that you can do is also build an ecosystem around the API, provide ways to try out the API, test the applications and let the app developers or API consumers to test their applications easily with your APIs, provide documentation, provide them with live help, provide them with SDKs so that they can easily use their favorite development platform to integrate with your or use your API, provide them with samples, so on and so forth. So these are different ways through which you can add value to your APIs and to the different stakeholders of your APIs. So increased value here also results obviously in the increased monetization opportunities for your APIs. So that's something that you will get in return when you do this. So that brings us to the principle number three, which is the API value chain. So what we mean by that is value increases as it flows through the digital supply chain. So once again, let me take an example and explain this. Let's think of the traditional way of obtaining a bank loan. So let's say somebody has bank accounts with multiple banks, and maybe with bank A and B, and then they want to apply for a bank loan, let's say to buy a house or buy something, and they apply for loans with multiple banks. So what do they have to do? They have to walk into each bank, get the information about the loan, and then share their financial details and asset information with each of the banks. And then they have to apply separately with each bank for the loan. And then they will have to wait for approval. So the banks behind the scenes, what they will do is do a creditworthiness check on the application or the applicant with the information that is available to them. And this process usually takes days, if not a week, or if not more, right? So this is generally the traditional way of obtaining a bank loan. Now, if we apply the integrated API supply chain concept to this domain, what do we get? I called it the financial services integrated API supply chain, but this is in turn what open banking kind of tries to adopt. Later during the day, Dasana is going to talk about open banking and some of these aspects in detail. But if we really apply this integrated API supply chain concept to this domain, what will happen is each bank will expose the account data or the data that they have about the consumers through the use of APIs, obviously with the consumer's consent. And then banks can not only share the account details or the payment details or payment information, but they can also share additional capabilities such as creditworthiness. If they have a system that they use to do this internally, they can expose that also as an API, as a functionality, and make that available as well. So a bank can access the account data at another bank, like you see here, where bank A accesses some of the account data, let's say at bank C. And that is done, that is facilitated through the use of APIs. So the bank can access account data at another bank using APIs. It can also, let's say, for example, use creditworthiness data available at bank C through also an API. So here you have multiple organizations working collaboratively through APIs. And that kind of connects these individual value chains together. So this is how the integrated supply chain works, basically. So a further step to this could be that there can be a brokerage firm, like a mortgage brokerage or a loan brokering firm. They may have their own application. Like in the previous case, the applicant can use an application to apply for a loan at multiple banks, and that application can be designed in such a way that it collects all the information required by multiple banks, general information that's required by all the different parties. So this application can obviously be using the APIs available at the different banks, and then the banks themselves can even use external services. For example, they can use something like a cloud service to add value to their APIs. So the cloud service might be, let's say, for example, providing additional sources of creditworthiness in this case. So there are cloud providers who provide AI-based creditworthiness checks that does analysis on the applicants based on things like social media profiles and so on. And there are businesses built on that business, on those concepts. So a bank, let's say, for example, Bank B use such a system from a cloud service provider, and they use that that data that they get through that API to add value to what they provide in turn to the application. So in summary, what happens here is high quality data and capabilities are delivered as value through the API supply chains. So this enables the banks to process the required information very efficiently and then present it to the decision makers effectively. So the decision making even can be automated to a certain extent, because you have all this information in an electronic form at your disposal now, and it is very easy for you to feed this in to a system that can make that decision looking at that data, which can either be also previously done using human intervention. So essentially what this does is it cuts down the time taken for pre-approval of the loan application, and this results in delivering a better customer experience here. So obviously the customer is going to be much more have a much more better experience, and they're going to be happy because of that. So this is one example of how integrated API supply chains can add value in such a scenario. And the value flows from one API to another, and through the usage of the APIs all the way to the end customer. So we have done something similar to this particular example with a First National Bank, South Africa's leading digital bank. So they use WC2 products to automate most of their loan processing and have achieved, they have achieved high levels of efficiency that has made them the number one digital bank in South Africa. And coincidentally, WC2 also powers the top three digital banks in South Africa. They all use WC2 technology to achieve digital, or rather they use WC2 technology to digitally transform themselves. And the first, second, and third ranked banks, both or all three, are using our WC2 customers. So open banking, like I said, open banking is also trying to do something like this, and that is eventually what they want to do. Some examples from open banking here. So Regional Australia Bank recently, a few months ago, approved open banking's first loan in Australia. So they demonstrated value exchange, where they received, so they partnered with another company called Basic. They received a personal loan application on the evening of July 1st. And with open banking, the applicant was able to securely share over 3,000 transactions as part of the application within a matter of seconds, right? And the application was filed under within 10 minutes. So there were two aspects to this. One is the sharing of data in a very easy way with the necessary parties, but also the applicant themselves had a very good experience because certain aspects in the application were pre-filled for them as part of this use experience. That is also adding value to this whole user experience. So behind all this, and of course they were able to share this information, and this whole process took no longer than 6 minutes end to end, right? So Basic, which is a fintech specializing in insights derived from financial data. So basically what Basic does is they have data analytic capabilities that they go and classify the applicant's expenses with the transactions that were shared with them. And then they analyze the spending, categorizing the transactions of the applicant's spending into different categories like transport, recreation, and so on. And they were able to do this within seconds, right? And then this in turn allowed, so Basic obviously provided these insights to Regional Australia Bank, and then Regional Australia Bank was able to make an automated loan decision based on the clear understanding of the individual's financial position as a result. So similarly, another example from the open banking world of such value additions through APIs is in November last year, a beauty salon in Kent became the first company to be granted a loan using open banking data. So that was done through a finance aggregator called Funding Options and Evoca. So the funding options basically gathers about 40 data points on how a company is performing. So the salon was able to actually obtain a loan of like 10,000 British pounds from Evoca in just under 83 minutes or under 90 minutes, right? So all of this will not work if not for the value that is delivered for the consumer eventually. There won't be traction in this without consumers seeing a value. And that is why these value chains and value additions are very important. So all of these are value derived from collaborations between different parties like fintechs and banks. And that's how the value chains or value propagates through the value chain, the supply chains rather. Right, so in yesterday's keynote, Shankar's keynote, you would have seen this whole concept of integrated supply chains for APIs. So if we apply the value chain concept onto this, we see value flows with each step of this supply chain. So you integrate your backends with the legacy systems. You may have multiple systems internally. You can integrate with them and then create value-added capabilities that are in turn exposed as APIs internally as well as externally. That itself is step number one of adding value. And then you can bring in insights and monetization mechanisms to add more value to that, which is another level on top of just having APIs. And then you can support all of this by having a properly managed DevOps operation, which can deliver better value for API developers eventually. And then going beyond that, having proper API product management adds further value to this, whole developer and API consumer experience, because the DevOps and the product management aspect takes care of those aspects as well. So this is how value flows through the integrated supply chain in each of these steps. So this is the case irrespective of what type of API architecture you use. You may use a centralized or a decentralized architecture, but basically if you apply these concepts of value chains, let's say you apply it at the utility APIs levels, that will eventually add value to the domain APIs that connect the utility APIs to the upper layers. And if you add value to the domain APIs, then that will result in more value being added to the edge APIs and so on. So the value flows within these networks, the layers rather, and you introduce value to each of the API layers in your architecture. And while I'm showing here a centralized layered architecture, this is the case also for a decentralized architecture. You can have these concepts applied to the individual cells or parts of your decentralized architecture as well. So that actually value chains don't really end there. That brings us to the principle number four, which is that API value chains can combine together to create API value networks. So API value networks, these are supported by API marketplaces and platforms. So API marketplaces and platforms are the ways that you can have sustainable ecosystems and network growth eventually. So this is why this is an important concept in API value chains. So the integrated supply chain, so if you look at the financial services API value chain, and if you look at the APIs at each of these organizations, if you apply the value chains here, or if you enable more and more value on the supply chain, value will naturally flow through each of the supply chains. And when these chains are connected together, obviously they will build a value network. So for example, if bank C adds more value to their APIs, bank A, who's the consumer of that API, benefits from it. And then because of that, bank A is now able to add more value to their APIs as a result. And eventually that will result in more value being added to the end customer who's using this application eventually. So that's how value flows through these value networks when the value chains are connected together. Right? So these value networks can be further facilitated through API marketplaces and platforms. So this is this might be something that you come across before. This is David Sachs' famous napkin diagram where he explains the Uber's business model. So the interesting thing is this particular diagram is very popular because this is a prime example of how networks thrive and create opportunities and positive value for all its stakeholders. Right. So for example, when there's more demand for rides, naturally more and more drivers will join the fray. So that results in better coverage geographically. And when you have better coverage, that results in faster pickups. So faster pickups obviously leads to more and more people wanting to use Uber service. So better geo coverage also results in less driver downtime, and that creates competition among drivers. And that results in Uber lowering the prices, which in turn results in more demand. So you can see how one aspect has an effect on the other, and then how this comes full circle eventually. And this is how networks create positive values for all its stakeholders. So something positive you do on one side becomes something positive on the other. So in the next session, so this is a diagram that shows is about an API marketplace. In the next session, Nadish is going to talk about API marketplaces in detail. However, in this context of delivering value and creating value networks, this is a very important concept. I believe it is the business platform of the 21st century, just like APIs are the products of the 21st century. And API marketplaces is like an evolution beyond the simple developer portal. A marketplace is where you would typically have APIs not only from a single vendor, but ideally from multiple vendors and producers. So such a marketplace would obviously have multiple APIs that does similar things from different vendors. However, the value each API may deliver might be different, right? And that is what creates competition among the sellers or the producers. So that results in better products and obviously incentives for buyers, because there's more competition now. And that is what we call as a same side network effect. So the competition that results within the buyers or between the buyers or the API producers. So if there are good APIs available, then obviously there will be more buyers or the API consumers joining the marketplace, and that will create a same side effect on the consumer side, where the buyers obviously, and when there's competition on that side, now buyers will obviously get better prices. They are able to get better prices for their APIs. So like in the Uber's case, Uber's business model, this will result in a cross-side network effect as well, because a higher consumer demand will also result in better products or better APIs from the producers. So this is how the whole network effects comes into play in an API marketplace. So API marketplaces have to have features and tools to make this sustainable. It has to have ways of supporting the full life cycle of an API, from being an API, from doing API first development, you may want to allow your potential users to try out your API before you deploy it in production, in order to, you know, make sure that your API product is a successful product when you launch it. So then you have to have ways of letting developers use your APIs when their apps are in development. So there have to be some sort of sandboxing environments that you can provide them with. And then once APIs are released, the marketplace should have ways and means of promoting the APIs through things like hackathons or workshops or other evangelizing activities, right? And of course, supporting that API product right throughout its life cycle. So in Nadish's session, I think he will go more in detail into some of these aspects. So to have a marketplace like that, you need a platform that gives you these capabilities, a platform that allows you to have an API-centric architecture of your choice, be it layered, centralized, or decentralized, and an architecture that aligns with your business models, and also has the ability to scale when you get more and more usage for your API products. So you also need a platform that is full-featured and gives you the flexibility to have your APIs. Let's say, for example, if you want to have them on-premise, on the cloud, or in a hybrid mode. It should also, you should go for a platform that gives you the chance of using the infrastructure of your choice, and has all the platform components that allow you to complete the API supply chain for your digital products. So not only that, it must be a platform that gives you the required components to create the value chain and the value networks right through your API supply chains. So it has to be a platform that has not only the API management components, but also components like integration and identity and access management. So this is WSO2's platform. It's not only, and it features not only the API management aspects, it has developer tooling, certain components that take care of the DevOps aspect, and then of course, the integration and identity and access management components that are there supporting the API management components of the platform. So subsequent talks during the day will go into some of these aspects in detail and talk about their part in the API supply chain and the value chain. So key takeaway from what I'd like to take you, you to take from this talk are that APIs are not just technical resources. They are important products that encapsulate your intellectual property, and you should therefore treat them as value APIs. Then a good integrated value chain, a value network, will compound your API growth and lead to, if you use the API platform for this, will lead to a sustainable platforms. And all of this, all of this is true, regardless of whether you're building the next big business or you're using APIs internally. And of course, all of this, you cannot really achieve this vision without a platform that scales, that has the flexibility of, gives you the flexibility of choosing the API architecture of your choice that aligns with your business model. Also has a proven track record, right, in the industry, and has all the components required to build the digital platform, the digital supply chain, and then on top of that, the value chain that you want. So look no further than WSO2.